Hey folks, this is Matt once again, and welcome back to another review. And this is for a 1997 film called The Game. And this is actually a DVD from overseas, thanks to a nice guy named Till from Germany for sending this. And I know there's like a Criterion Blu-ray or whatever, but apparently it seems like this pretty much has all the features that are on that, and I'm fine with this DVD. For example, it has commentary with David Fincher and Michael Douglas and some other folks that record separately. You have a teaser trailer, the regular trailer, alternative ending, which is not much difference, to be honest. Some behind the scenes, and what I mean by that is showing on set. But unfortunately, no documentary, no featurettes. Which is too bad. But I'm glad to have this because the DVD I had was bare bones. And this is actually from the teaser trailer, which I had never seen the teaser trailer before I saw this DVD. And it's on YouTube. I'm going to put the link down below because I think it's one of the best teaser trailers I've seen. I just really like the way it's simple but yet effective. It has this figure. And as the teaser goes along, you hear the dialogue, it gets more and more pulled in different directions, which makes sense for what this movie's about. Now, The Game, David Fincher films, a little bit there. David Fincher flicks, to be honest, there's a lot that I like. Alien 3 I hate, but I really enjoy 7. I do like 7. Really enjoy this film. This came out after 7. I like Panic Room. Curious Case of Benjamin Button I don't care for. Zodiac I would like to pick up one day on DVD to give it another look. Social Network, that was sent to me and I did a review and I hated The Social Network. I thought it was an extremely overrated movie. Extremely overrated. I think is miles upon miles better than The Social Network, and yet The Social Network got Academy Awards, nominations, and humongous box office. But this film, it got some good critical notices, but it didn't get any, like, awards. Definitely no Oscars, no Golden Globes, nothing. No nominations, let alone any wins. And it didn't really do that well at the box office. But yet The Social Network and Curious Case of Benjamin Button, those got all the accolades. I don't understand that. Almost all of David Fincher's films have a good rating on IMDb. Even Alien 3 has like a 6.3 or 6.4, which I think is too high. But pretty much all of David Fincher's films has good ratings on IMDb, including this one, so that's nice. But I think this is hell up. I'll get to that. Girl with the Dragon Tattoo I haven't seen. I've heard of. I know it's a remake of a film from overseas, but I haven't seen that film. I haven't seen Gone Girl. Maybe when it comes out on DVD, I'll give it a look, but it's a film that I have no interest in seeing in a theater. It's pretty much all of David Fincher's films. But yeah, I mean, yeah, Zodiac, I'd like to pick up one day and give it another look. I'll say right now, this is my favorite David Fincher film. I like 7. I like this film the most. I think it always has been, always will be my favorite David Fincher flick. Yeah, I think it's a very well-done thriller. I think Michael Douglas does a great job in his role as Nicholas Van Orden. Sean Penn has a small role. He's about 3 scenes or so. But he does a good job, as well as Deborah Kara Unger, James Reborn, Armin Mueller-Stahl. The general plot is Nicholas Van Orden. He's a banker. He's an investment banker. And he gets his present from his brother, Sean Penn. And I remember hearing somewhere, reading up somewhere, that Jodie Foster at one time was going to do the film, either as, I think, Michael Douglas's sister or daughter, which that'd be weird. That doesn't make sense. But I remember hearing that Jodie Foster was going to be a part of this, but that didn't work out. And then, really enough, of course, Jodie Foster would be in Panic Room, which I think that film was supposed to be like Nicole Kidman or someone like that. And then Jodie Foster got the job. So it's weird how that all works out. So Jodie Foster would eventually work with David Fincher. But anyway, Michael Douglas gets a present from Sean Penn. And I want to get the initials down. It was CRS, Consumer Recreational Service. And this guy tells him it's a game. It's a game that you don't know when it's going to start. But as Sean Penn says, it makes your life fun. Or James Redhorn says, well, we found out what's lacking, what's missing. And Michael Douglas goes, well, what if nothing is missing? What if nothing is lacking? And pretty much the game starts, and kind of like this video here, Michael Douglas' character is pulled in a lot of different directions. And that's the best way I can say anything without giving anything away. This is a review. Every review I do spoilers, but this is going to spoilers now. But I really enjoy this film. I think it's well shot. I think it's well acted. I think the story and the plot is intriguing. And a lot of people are pissed at the ending. I enjoyed the ending. I'll get into that. I thought Michael Douglas knocked out of the park. I think he's really liked him as an actor. And Falling Down and a lot of other films. Romancing the Stone. And yeah, it is a well shot. Has some really... I gotta go into spoilers when we're gonna talk about this. First off, the Michael Douglas character. I like the way he has a little bit of an arc, which is the whole point of the movie, which is the whole point of the game. Because at the beginning of the film, the character Michael Douglas plays, he's cold, he's distant, he's unemotional. You tell he's pretty much a bit dead inside. And you find out backstory, which I thought I liked this, that his father had committed suicide. And his father, it's kind of what Michael Douglas is sort of becoming his own father. Where he's all about work. Michael Douglas used to be married, but now he sort of brushes off his ex-wife when she calls on his birthday. He eats alone in his big old house. Doesn't speak to his brother Sean Penn much, especially as of late. And you can tell the guy is unhappy. You can tell he's pretty much unemotional, kind of dead. And then when Sean Penn puts this game into it, he's like, oh, I don't know about this. Goes into it. And even the guy says, you can't tell me that you're not at least intrigued. And he is intrigued. And actually, on his birthday, he's the same age as his dad. I believe the same age as his dad when he committed suicide. So, again, this is spoilers. So this is for people who have seen the film. You get the idea that if it wasn't for the game, he would have taken his own life. And he probably would have gone the route of his own dad. But what the game does, of course you don't know this the first time you're watching it, but because when you're watching this film, you don't know what the game is about. You don't know if it's a bunch of con artists who are doing this for his money. You don't know what's real and what's not. Up until the end, you don't know what's real and what's not. Is it a game? Are these actual bad guys? Or is it part of the game? And you find out at the end, which I really enjoy the way the movie ends. But has to do some of these tests. And he has to like reading off these questions, these really personal questions. And he's even looking at this projector and has to push these buttons. And I just like the way that the film looks. I think it's a really good-looking film. I think it's well shot. And he even gets a call saying, trying to remember. I was thinking of the test sequence. There was something I was trying to remember, and I remember what it is now. And it's when you watch it a second time that you go, oh, that's kind of cool. It's one of the tests they're doing these cards. And there's one of the cards that has a car going off the road. And all Michael Douglas, when he sees the car, because he's supposed to be used, look at the card and what do you want to say? What's the first word that pops in your head? And he goes, whoops. But the reason I mention that is later on in the film, there is a scene where he gets in a taxi and it drives. The driver gets out. He's stuck in the back and it goes off the road into the water. So you watch it again and go, oh my God, that's a scene that we're going to see later. It's the one scene that Michael Douglas said sort of a sarcastic thing, like, whoops. And, like, did they look at that and go, okay, we gotta have a scene like that later on? People who constructed this game. And I thought, you know, I'm watching it again, I'm like, oh yeah, that's actually kind of cool. It's a little thing that I thought was pretty cool. And you can kind of see clues as to, I don't know why people were so angry about the ending, because I might as well talk about the ending now just to jump ahead. You find out he's on top, he's got a gun. Like, oh no, you have a gun? What? He shoots, thinks it's going to be someone else, and finds out it's his own brother, Sean Penn. And then he freaks out, he commits suicide like his father did. But then when he crashes through this glass, there's a humongous airbag at the bottom of it. And then Sean Penn arrives at the bottom there, and there's like all of Michael Douglas's friends, or, well, not really friends, but you know, associates, his ex-wife, everyone there. And you find out, okay, this is part of the game. And I don't know if it's because this came out after the end of 7. Because the ending of 7, you can't get more downbeat than what's in the box. I think people expected a downer ending for this film, and they felt cheated because it didn't have a downer ending. But I kind of like that. It played, it's kind of like the original April Fool's Day, which I would say I like the original April Fool's Day more, but I like that it played it off that it's not what you expected. It wasn't what I expected, because I'm thinking of the 7, the first time I saw this way back when. I don't think it's going to end the same way. And I was really surprised. I thought it played off expectations. I thought the ending was actually better for it. It was better as a story. I think it has a rewatchability. I think if it ended with Michael Douglas just committing suicide, like his father, this would not have a rewatchability. But to me, it does have a rewatchability, because you see that throughout the film, he becomes from a dead, unemotional guy to wanting to fight for his life, and he's, you know, more intense, more gets angry, and you see that, you know, you see stuff like Scare Tactics or Punked or Candid Camera or the Jamie Kennedy Experiment, all these hidden camera shows, you know, they'll get mad, angry, pissy, whatever. But then when they find out it's not real and it's all okay, then they're happy and they're elated. And then it's like, wow, that was a fun experience. It's weird, but you watch enough candid camera type shows, like all the ones I mentioned, the hidden camera shows, that is true. Punt, Scare Tactics, the most horrible thing can happen. Then you find out it's not real. You kind of have this rush that you were able to live even like a teeny tiny movie. And anyway, I have to mention that. But I like the, you know, some people were really pissed off about the ending, but the reason I mentioned that, there are clues. Like, you talk to these guys, and what was it they said? He was asking these guys, what's the game about? And one guy goes, once I was blind, and now I see. And that's sort of the thing, is that at the beginning of the film, Michael Douglas' character, he's very unemotional, he's, you know, very private, solitary, just about his work. And as the film, he gets more and more to it. Starts off simple. He has a briefcase, he can't open it, trying his best. He becomes a bit more paranoid. He has this pen that was given to him, and it leaks out ink. and he washes it off, and he sees stuff in the bathroom, and it's like he's not sure, is this part of the game, is it not? He becomes more paranoid. He drives home, and there's like a fucking clown doll, and he sets it up, and the news that he watches all of a sudden it sort of comes alive and starts talking directly to him, and shows that that sort of creepy looking doll actually has a camera in its eye. I like the way it's shot, I like the way it's filmed, I like the idea behind it. And I think he like finds a key or something in its mouth. I forget if it was his mouth, but and all sorts of stuff starts happening. I mean, he shows some people, see, I signed this, and they looked at it, and they go, what? There's nothing here. And he realizes that the game, the people behind it, had written it in ink, invisible ink, so that when he showed it later, there was nothing there. One time he comes home, and there's all this graffiti, but it's like from a black light. So it has that black light look. I don't know how else to describe it, but you know, you turn the, if you see pictures or a trailer, you know what I'm talking about. That black light type of look. I thought it was kind of cool looking set. I don't know how else you describe it. He meets this girl who's a waitress and tries to talk with her because he thinks he got her fired and wants to talk to her. And they get chased. Well, actually, they help this guy who they think is this bum who they think is choking. They get to a hospital, and all of a sudden, everyone else disappears, and all the lights come down, and they're empty in the parking garage of this hospital. They have to get through this elevator, and they have to get through this and that. And even to a point, they get chased by dogs. Oh, there goes $1,000. Your shoes cost $1,000? That one did, because he lost his shoe from one of the dogs. He gets a call that his credit card has been found. He's like, what credit card? What? And he goes in, there's like porn playing, and there's dirty pictures all around, and just stuff that really upsets him, of course, unsettles him, riles him up. And has to figure out what the hell to do. And they really do some stuff like what, and the blacklight scene when he goes into his home. The actual, I think they have like pictures or such of his dead dad who had committed suicide. He goes, you fuckers. You fuckers. And again, of course, when you watch it a second, third time, you know what's going on, but it's a nice experience living through the eyes of Michael Douglas's character, at least for me. And you see him, you know, give a little bit more emotional, a little bit more life to him. And I really like that. I mean, even to the point where Sean Penn talks to him, it's like, I paid him more to stop. And Sean Penn thinks, you're in on it. What are you talking about? You brought him to me. And Sean Penn runs away. Michael Douglas tries to catch him. That's where he gets the cab ride from hell. Where he did, the cab driver jumps out and fucking car ride, cab flies right into the river, and he's got to escape with this little thing that he was given earlier in the film to use. And even just to a point where you find out the waitress is in on it, and before that, he's at her place and there's gunshots, and okay, are they real gunshots or are they squibs? And he gets drugged and left in Mexico, and he actually comes clawing out of like a coffin, and this looks like a crypt, not really a crypt, but a mausoleum or something like that. And you just consistently feel bad and more bad for this character. I mean, he's got like the cut on his nose or whatever. He's little bit unshaven because he's been drugged and put into a damn coffin, left in Mexico. He has no money. All he can do is give away his last name, which is a watch that his father had given him. And just fucking really feel bad for him. And he has a nice scene where he gets back and he talks with his ex-wife who... some of these people don't know anything that's going on. Like, his ex-wife never knew anything that was going on. And so Michael Douglas has this nice scene where he says, you know what, I get why you left me. I get why you did this and did that. And then wants to turn the tables on the people who fucked him over. Gets one of the actors of the game, pulls a gun on him. You have this fun scene. Someone tries to carjack him. And he goes, I'm extremely fragile right now. And he pulls a gun like right to it. Like, doesn't even look at the guy. He's like, I'm extremely fragile right now. Kind of like, leave me the fuck alone. I'm going to shoot you in the face. Even gets to the actor, says, you know, I'm a very dangerous man right now. Gets him into the CRS, the Consumer Recreational Service. Gets chased, gets that waitress girl, gets on top, and again, he thinks he killed his brother, and it was, you know, it was all fake. Then he jumps in and goes, no, that was fake. Airbag. I like that Sean Penn comes out, he has this t-shirt, like, I was drugged and left in Mexico, and all I got with this was a stupid t-shirt. And, yeah, I was thinking, well, why doesn't Michael Douglas punch some people and go, what the fuck? But I'm trying to put myself in that situation. If I had a brother... Well, I do have a brother, but if I thought he was dead, that I had killed him, and then I see that he's alive, I probably would have been just so relieved that I kind of let her go. Again, that's what I'm talking about, like that candid camera, scare tactics, punt, all that stuff. And, you know, most of them, you see them laughing and smiling. Even if they're scared or angry or pissed off, they're laughing. So, because I think just out of relief. And the ultimate ending is pretty much just him walking out, walking down the street. And the ending here, it's, you know, chatting with folks, chatting with Sean Penn, and then going up to the waitress and sort of deciding, you know, whether to go get a cup of coffee with her. And it's something he would never have done in the beginning of the film. I love the way it ends with the song White Rabbit by Jefferson Airplane. I thought that was like a great song to end the film to. And I think the film is a really interesting film. I never got bored. Never got bored with the film at all. I think it's a good-looking, well-shot movie. The score, that piece of music at the end. I think Michael Douglas did a fantastic job acting-wise. I thought the rest of the cast, there's not a bad point in the cast. Always kept my interest. Even me watching it, knowing it, just living it through Michael Douglas's eyes and seeing how he's like this. He's being pulled in so many different directions. And then there is a difference between by the end of it, and there is a reason for it. Granted, the people behind the game gave some pretty low blows. You know, like showing pictures of his dead dad and stuff like that, but at the same time, you get the idea that I think even Sean Penn says, I had to do it, you becoming an asshole, or throws out a line like that or something, but like in a funny way, not in a mean way. And again, you get the idea that he's the age of his dad who committed suicide, who was a workaholic, kind of like him, a lot like him, and that if this didn't happen, he may have followed his father's footsteps and committed suicide, but here he kind of has a new lease on life. He has a new energy on life. He's sort of alive again. At the beginning, he's dead inside here. At the end, he's alive again because of this weird thing that happened. That's what, to me, gives us a rewatchability. Other than Seven, I think that's I like Seven, but I think that's a problem with Seven for me, is that it kind of doesn't have much rewatchability, because Brad Pitt and Morgan Freeman lose. They didn't catch the killer. The killer gave himself up. All they're doing is five steps behind the killer, and then again, the killer, Kevin Spacey, gives himself up, so they didn't really accomplish much in their investigation. They didn't really do much. And then they still lose anyway because Brad Pitt's woman is dead and her unborn baby. And Brad Pitt shoots and he's going to be put in jail, mental asylum, whatever the fuck. And all you get is, okay, Morgan Freeman's not going to retire. So he cannot solve another case again. Because he didn't really solve this case. It was Kevin Spacey solved it for them. And he won. So it's kind of hard to rewatch 7 because it's a good movie. Just not a lot of rewatchability factor. To me, this has a rewatchability factor. And I think it's an interesting story. I think it's entertaining thriller. I think it has a good cast. One of my favorite Michael Douglas performances. Overall, really enjoyed the game. Really liked this film. I think I would say it's underrated because I guess it cost like 40, 50 million and only made 60 million in the US. So it didn't really do well. I mean, Panic Room did well and other films did well, but this film didn't do well when it came out. Got a couple of good critical notices, but nothing awards wise. It's like he had the big hit, then he did the film after, and it wasn't. That happens a lot. Eddie Murphy had Beverly Hills Cop. They did Golden Child, which I love. Wasn't much of a hit. Or it was a disappointment. Same with Cobra after Rambo 2 and Rocky 4. Same with a lot of films, apparently, now that I realize it. But I really enjoy the game. So, either way, thanks for watching. Take care. And we'll see you later. Bye-bye.